Cool, it's 6 p.m. here, so 9 a.m. In the US, where probably everyone is preparing for turkey coma today and for Thanksgiving. So I hope all our American friends will have a really enjoyable holiday. But for everyone else, I'm super excited about this topic. Thanks a lot to Marcus for offering to present. Software analytics is really interesting because all the software projects that we deal with are actually graphs. So no matter if you look into like software code structures, which are ASTs, which are trees, dependency networks, module dependencies, call graphs, memory heaps, all the stuff is actually connected information. And it's really easy to get this data into Neo4j. Actually, it was my first test project when I came across Neo4j in 2008, which is almost 10 years ago now. Really long time ago. My first attempt was actually to import the Java development kit with ASM into Neo4j, and which then sparked actually the development of JQ Assistant, which my friend Dirk is maintaining mainly and has now already a lot of really interesting users and use cases, and there's a lot of really interesting information around this. So Marcus will talk about some of this. And you can find a lot of information from Marcus on his blog called feststelltested.de, which is the same as Caps Lock in German. And so there's a lot of really interesting content around software analytics and graphs and connected data. For instance, Adam Thornhill's Code Scene is really interesting. And there are also a lot of presentations from Dirk, from Marcus, and other people around data visualization around software analytics and also graph operations on top of that. And so without further ado, I would like to hand over to Marcus for presentation. So I'll mute myself and leave it to Marcus to take on for the presentation. Go ahead.
So, hi. My name is Marcus. And welcome to this Neo4j online meetup about, as Michael said, software analytics with Jupyter, Pandas, JQ Assistant, and Neo4j. So let's take a look at the screen sharing here. All right. So this should work. So, a few words about me. Well, I'm Marcus, and I'm actually a normal software developer working in the financial area in Nuremberg, here in Germany. And what I do during the day is Java development in an enterprise environment. But in my free time, I took the role of software development analyst. And what I do is data analysis and software development. And this comes from my main areas of interest, because I like to code in an agile way, do clean coding, clean architecture, and I'm very interested in software archaeology as well as software revival. And with this, I go really back to the roots of software development. And I'm also interested here in epistemology, the theory of knowledge, as well as cognitive psychology. You can follow me on Twitter at feststelltested. And you see also my blog and my email address here. So I also started consulting in 2018. I want to provide some trainings and workshops in this area of data analysis and software development. So let's have a look at the agenda. First, I want to motivate why you should do data analysis in software development. We take a brief look at software analytics, and then I show you how you can implement software analytics. And after that, we have a look at some examples and demos, and then we conclude, and we have plenty of time for questions and answers as well. What drives me to do this analysis stuff in software development? I think that everything is wrong with software development, at least kind of. And I want to show you why. So just imagine that this is a surface. It's a UI of an application that an end user is using. And your manager, as well as all those non-technical people, see each day. So if they take a look on the surface, everything seems fine. So there's absolutely no problem to say that under the surface or under the hood, everything is fine too. So non-technical people often say or think that there's a diamond under the hood where the software is very good as well and well structured as it is on the surface, on the UI. But, well, the thing is, it's not. So in many discussions there or meetings, non-technical people are very, very happy. They can show the customers what's going on in the application. But if you meet with some developers in a pub, well, some misunderstandings or some contrary meanings about the software they are maintaining. So after one beer, a developer could say that he is very disappointed with the software and how slow it's going on. So he does some refactoring or re-engineering. He follows their clean code principles. But in the end, he cannot really do much in the software because you have some restrictions. You have an architecture that's given and that has to be followed. So you can't really do in a daily work any real work or to fix the system sustainable. After 2 beers, well, the developers say, well, we had a talk with our business people and I saw some really, really severe bugs. And they said, don't worry. We sell the customer those bugs as change requests so that we can get some money from that. And a few days later, you say, hey, there's a severe bug as well. And the business people say, well, don't worry, we sell that and so on. But this bug could actually really stop production and make your company bankrupt, for example. So there's a real lack of communication or the lack of the mean of communicating severe bugs, but also a way where there's also missing a way where developers can understand what the business people really want. And third, we have mostly in legacy code structures or architectures that can't be changed very easily because someone decided years ago how the software should be signed and they found it really, really cool to do it that way. And as a new developer, you also don't have the means to really improve the software because someone said it is so. I have decided that you have to do it. So in reality, developers take a look bottom up and they often see not so nice things here. And this not so nice things also shine through the nice surface. And eventually you have a software system that's not maintainable and that you can throw away or rewrite. But admit it, there are some kind of nice things in here, but nobody knows it. So the question is why software development is still so crazy. I found a nice little model here that's called the wall of ignorance between the management and the developer. It says that developers have to cross this huge wall by making their work more visible to management. But it's not, as I told before, a bottom-up only strategy, but also a top-down. So management must have the means to the means to communicate their risk-taking. I mean, management is responsible for the success of a company, and an important parameter for this is this risk-taking. And you have to communicate to the developers which games you play and which are not. And developers have to say, well, this risk is too risky here. We can really break the system with this change and so on. So you have to enforce those communication and to get rid of this wall of ignorance. So my wife, she's controller. She said to me once, hey, why do you have so much problems here in software development? I mean, just take the data and analyze it and go to management and get some budget for improvements. So what she suggested to me is what business people do all day. They do data analysis to quantify the things you can see and also do also estimate the risks that some risky endeavor can have. So the thing is, why do we software developers not also execute some data analysis on our own software data? So this is where I started researching some papers, what's going on in the academic world. And I found this nice little topic, software analytics. And for me, software analytics is some sober problem solving with data analysis based on software data. So let's briefly have a look how software analytics is defined. I found that definition from Tim Menzies and Thomas Zimmerman. And they say, software analytics is analytics on software data for managers and software engineers with the aim of empowering software development individuals and teams, and to gain and share insight from their data to make better decisions. So the first time I read this, I thought, well, it's exactly the thing that I need, because in the first sentence or in the first paragraph, they state that they do analytics on the software data. That's what we developers produce every day, with the goal to provide information for managers and software engineers or for developers. And that's really cool. So I dig deeper into that topic. And so I wanted to find the right insights. I wanted to use software analytics to get better insights to make better decisions. So in general, this topic isn't new, because you have all those software metrics tools that deliver you some kind of cyclomatic complexity of your class. And software measurement is a topic from the 70s of the last century. So if you look which questions those older tools are answering, they are targeted at the area of the very frequently asked questions. And for this, the last years, we produced some tools that can somehow answer those questions. These are questions like, is my public API documented? Or am I really conform with the naming conventions of some class names, for example? And they do a really good job in there. Some products are SonarQube or Ndepend in this area. But the question for me is, how does that fit within a scale of risk or value? Because the question is asked very frequently, it doesn't mean that the question is also a risky problem. So the risk curve could be something like this. You could have one or two questions in your application, when they are unanswered, they could break the whole system or could lead to your production failures. So what software analytics does is to exactly tackle or trying to tackle the high risk problems here. So when a developer says something like, this is really a design smell in my software, some software development analyst, for example, can investigate, is this really a big problem? Can design some analysis and do some proper problem solving in this area. So what are some types of software data that you can analyze? There are four categories. Some static data, that's mainly the things that we software developers produce every day, like some code or some architecture descriptions, documentations, and so on. You have runtime information. There you have some call traces or log files that you can also have a look into. And there's some chronological data. That's data from Git repositories or the ticket systems. And last, you have some community repositories. That are mainly targeted for academics that can try where they try to build up models that are generally valid in this time. But also there are some dumps from GitHub or Travis CI continuous integration services where you have a look in some build logs, for example. And the important part is that problems are interconnected, and so should we thrive to connect those software data sources as well. So my guideline here, because software analytics could be some kind of buzzword, so my guideline is just to take all this knowledge that's already there in data science and just to adopt it that it fits on software data. And I try to do it with this methodology. So I want to tackle some problems in a very automated way, because I'm mainly a software developer. I don't have much time to do all those analysis manually. I need something that I can automate. And my analysis have to be data driven, because where else should I take the hints for problems in my software? I don't have anything other than data here. And third, it's the most important point here. I have to do my analysis reproducible, because I could make many, many mistakes in my data analysis process. So others have to look or have to be enabled to look at my findings and my conclusions to find errors or to learn from everybody else. So how does it work now? So why does it work now? Software measurement tools are around for a few years. You also have data science methodologies that are around for 5 years, something like this. But why should you now those data analysis and software development? There are three main points here. One thing is because of microservices, the topic domain-driven design is back here in the development area. And this domain-driven design thinking brings more and more business logic into your own code. That's one point. So the business language goes directly into code. And therefore, the developers get some grasp or feeling for their business that they are implementing. The second thing is that data science enables problem analysis now for developers as well. Developers write all those tools that data scientists use. Why shouldn't developers use those tools and analyze their own data? So I see that more and more developers could use those tools to identify really, really, really hard problems in their own code. Third, there are some new tools out there that can create higher level concepts. That means that you aren't on a class level in the Java world or on a function level, but you can create some higher level meaning. And this is the point where I say it's really important, because you can take all those details that are down there in your code, abstract them, and because your code is somehow in a business language, the business can understand what you're talking about. So that's the main point. Why does it work now? The problems that you see in your code can be connected to concepts that are in business terms. So let's have a look how you can implement software analytics. So the thing is, what can you do today? Is it worthwhile to go now into the topic of software analytics? I think, of course, yes. Because what you can do, for example, is take some easy steps and get familiar with all the tooling by, for example, visualizing developer contributions over time. You can also identify some unused error-prone or embedded code, as we'll see later. The next category is you can create a code or a problem inventory for legacy systems, where you describe the things your system is made up and document it, and also list it as Excel files or something like this. This gives you a good overview of the things your system is made of. You can also find some performance bottlenecks by analyzing call trees from performance measurements. And you can also visualize some unwanted dependencies between modules. If you want to build microservice, for example, you can figure out which modules shouldn't communicate with each other, and you can make some improvement work on this. But the thing is, in my opinion, make the most powerful thing is what you can do with software analytics is to make your specific problems in your own software system visible. For example, you can analyze some race conditions, architecture smells, build breakers, or programming errors. And for this category, I think there won't be any general available tool out there in the future, because those problems are so specific and only existing in your application that no vendor wants to create such a tool. So you have to write it on your own. How can you do it? The main point is, as I said before, we are developers. We have to code. We don't have much time to do such analysis stuff. So try to choose known tools, for example, Python or Java 9 or Bash Shell even, or use tools for Plan B. And Plan B, I mean, these are tools that are trendy in these days, for example, Neo4j, Pandas, or Spark. And these could be probably tools that you want to learn in the future. The important point is that you have to use a suitable platform where you can do all this reproducible stuff, where you can have an open analysis that other developers can follow. So the main point is here, tools shouldn't stand in the way. This should get out of the way. You should just analyze your problem and solve it. The main key that I use is this notebook approach. So I see it kind of an open dialogue with data. We see here a paper from Albert Einstein, where he does such analysis. So what he does is he documents the context. So where do I come from? What's the problem I'm researching? Then he writes down all the ideas, some assumptions or heuristics that he needs to do to get something out here. Then every pre-processing here is also justified. So in the case of Albert Einstein, it's easy because he just has math. It's you cannot pre-process anything that's not valid here. His calculations here are understandable, at least for mathematicians. And his summaries are hopefully concluded. So he also does some nice visualization here to show his point. If we take an abstract view on this notebook approach, what you have is you have some problem here that you want to have a look at. And this problem is always dependent on your context you are working in. You describe something, where does that come from? Is there some ticket? Is there a developer that has this problem? And you describe how you would approach that in the next section with the idea. And you can do some analysis on this, maybe visualize it. And at last, you have some conclusion that lead you to some, solutions in the best case. So how far away am I from this approach? Well, it turns out not very far, because I already have some tools available that can do that. And the main point is here also that everything here, what you see, is automated. So let's have a quick look at this notebook-driven data analysis. What you see here is Jupyter, and there you write down where you come from. You have some code in there that do your analysis. After every code part, you can output the results or the immediate steps. You can do some visualization and write down your conclusion. We will code that later on. So let's move on now. Here you can see my basic tooling that I'm currently using. As I said, the main platform for doing all this is Jupyter. Jupyter is an interactive notebook. It's kind of a central hub for data analysis and documentation. And then we need a powerful programming language, where I chose Python, because at this point, Python is the data scientist's best friend. And Python is very easy to use, effective, and a very fast programming language, because some libraries that Python uses are compiled in C. Next, we need something to analyze data structures. Here I use Pandas. It's a pragmatic data analysis framework. It provides you with great data structures and integration with various machine learning libraries. And in my recent analysis, I also used D3, a JavaScript visualization library for data-driven documents. And it's just kind of beautiful and gives you very easy means to produce interactive graphics. But here we are in the Neo4j online meetup. And what would it be without Neo4j? So with the advanced tooling pipeline here, I'm using JQ Assistant. JQ Assistant is, a structural code analysis tool where you can scan your software structures. You can combine it with documentation. And then you can check if your code conforms to the documentation by validating it. How does it work? So the main ideas are that you scan software structures like your Java source code, some Git repositories, even a database schema, and you store all that data in the Neo4j database. And then you execute some queries. For example, you examine some relationships and add some cipher queries to it to find some thing or some problems in your code base. What you can do is also use to add some high level concepts. That means you don't only have classes or the functions, but build up hierarchies that have some higher level meaning. And you also can validate rules via constraints. That means that you can search for violations of your rules. And finally, you can generate reports that show you all those violations that are in your code base. So the main use case for JQ Assistant is, in my view, a living self-validating architecture documentation. What does it mean? So when you build a software, you also always have a documentation, and it's quickly outdated. What JQ Assistant tries to combine this documentation with your source code. So what you do is you write some ASCII documentation what your software consists of, how is the architecture of my software, and so on. You define some concepts. Do my database object look like? Use some patterns that are in my software. And you can also export or visualize some basic diagrams from some important concepts of your software. So I hadn't this use case in mind when I was in search for a tool that could help me in my daily work. So where I started was doing some design or code reviews in my company. And there I found out that somehow the things that I do are kind of automated or are really repetitive and also boring. So I searched for a way that makes this boring work well for me. And that's where I found GQ Assistant, because in an IDE, I figured somehow out that navigating based on the structural information of my Java program, and GQ Assistant provides this structural information or stores that in the Neo4j database. So that's the thing that I don't have to navigate in my integrated development environment anymore. And just write some Cypher queries that do the work for me. And in recent times, I also find that I can add the business perspective into my code base by adding some higher level concepts here. So if you have a Java class here, the pet class in blue, colored in blue, you can add an additional relationship to something that the business people can know. So in this case, I added a business domain node that says, well, all this code that belongs to this business domain pet. Let's first have a look here in Neo4j in the schema before we dive into this graph again. So what you have are some nodes, including some node labels, and GQ Assistant can scan things like files, classes, methods, or commits of Git repositories. You can also have properties for each of those nodes, like the name of the file, the full qualified name of a class, the signature of a method, or the message that describes the things that developers committed to the Git repository. And you have some relationships between all those nodes. For example, in the case of the file could be a zip file and it contains some other files. The class could depend on other classes, and the method could invoke something else, and the commit could contain some changes. So that's the idea. And you can query things you like. So you can use that file with name that contains something else. You can use that class with a full qualified name. It depends on something. You can use the method with a signature that invokes anything, the commit message that contains the change. That's the idea behind it, behind the schema. So let's have a look at some Cypher queries. How could it look like to query some software structures? Here we see a query that says, well, please, Neo4j, give me all database objects. And in a Java world, you can identify those database objects by the use of some specific frameworks. And our framework here in this case would be that we identify each database object by these, which are classes that are annotated by a specific other class. So what we do here is where we say, well, match for all types, that are annotated by an annotation of type A. And this A is something from this persistence framework, and it's called javax.persistence.entity. And if I fire this query against my Neo4j database, I get this subgraph, and I can determine or define that my pet class here is an entity. So that's a database object. So before I get to the demos, let's have a look at my complete toolchain that I'm working with today. The base for all this is Jupyter and Python. And then we have some data that comes in to this pipeline, where you have some text, some source code, for example, or table-like structures. And you also have some graph-like data. I like to read in those text or table data with pandas and everything that's kind of a graph with the Q assistant. Then I analyze specific to the use case or the problem I'm researching right now with pandas, or I'm using pandas on Neo4j. And I output the data as I need it, for example, in PowerPoint presentations or in Excel files, or you can also plot the results directly in those Jupyter notebooks, or you can create interactive diagrams with D3. So let's have a look at the toolchain. What can you do? I wrote about several analyses that I did on my blog, and I want to show you the main ideas behind this. So first, I have an example here that's called production coverage. With this analysis, the main idea is to find unused code. And that can you, and this can be achieved by reading some coverage data into your data framework. And that means that you measure the coverage, the code coverage in production. That means you add some agent that tracks which code is covered during normal user operations. And then you can take that data, read it into your data frame or into your data analysis framework, and calculate some ratio of covered lines to all lines. And third, you can visualize some usage hotspots with an hierarchical bubble chart. So this bubble chart we are seeing on the right side, we have some hotspots that are colored red, and some code that's not getting executed at all in colored in blue. So let's see how much work this is to do. So what I'm doing here is I'm firing up Jupyter notebook, and we want to create a new analysis notebook, our production coverage here, and we load here pandas, our data analysis framework. Look, we can have a look at it. What is it? Well, pandas is a powerful data analysis and manipulation library for Python. And what I have here is a short report about the coverage measures from a live run from an application. And this file is stored in a CSV file under data. And here we are. So I just wrote in the complete CSV file here with all the measurements. And the measurements say, here is my package, Oryx Spring Framework samples pet clinic. Here's a class. It says, well, it's called pet clinic initializer. And we have also some measures like how many lines were missed during execution, and how many lines were covered. So we can store it in a variable here, forEach.head. So we only see the 5 top entries here. And what we can do here, for example, if we want to know are there any packages that are completely unnecessary here, we can say, well, let's group all that data by packages and sum the rest up. You can see we summed up all those packages. And we have, for example, the lines covered here. And we see, oh, there's a package with 0. We want to investigate that further. So we just select this column here. And this gives us a brief overview which packages here are used or are not used at all. Because we want to present it to management that we have to delete some code, we directly plot here a nice bar chart that we can print out and show management. So that's it. That's a quick analysis of the use code per package here. So a similar visualization is here, the next example called Knowledge Island. What you do here is you take your Git repository and create a log file with numstats. This will give you statistics for each file. And it says, yeah, well, how many additions or deletions or lines of code did every developer contribute in history of the software project? What you do as a second step is you calculate then the proportional contributions for each source code file per author. That means that you take a look at which developer contribute the most lines of code. And then you visualize the ownership of those per source code file, again with this hierarchical bubble chart. As you can see on the right side, you have some white colored classes here. The bubbles are here the classes with the metric of lines of code. So the size represents the lines of code. And the color here says in white says that you don't have any knowledge islands here. And if you have other colors than white, it says, well, for example, on the left side, you have those red bubbles. There is one developer who possesses the knowledge for those 4 files here. So you should have a look at it and say, well, can we spread the knowledge better? So this analysis, by the way, was highly influenced by the work of Adam Thornhill, who wrote a very good book on the topic called Your Code as a Crime Scene. So let's get into those JQ Assistant and Neo4j analysis topics. What I have here is a dependency analysis between bounded contexts. And this one shows you which business concepts are dependent on each other. So let's fire that up here to get a better look at it. Here we have a code diagram where you can see that this pet subdomain has 49 dependencies, where most of those dependencies are in those pet subdomain itself. But it also references some other things or classes here in this case to other subdomains like the owner with 5 dependencies and a clinic with 4. So how much work is it to do here? It boils down to this Cypher query where you say, well, I have some subdomain, and to the subdomain, there are some types or Java types that belong to the subdomain. And please give me all the other dependent types that are that this one type references. So all the other types, the dependencies, belong also to some other subdomains. And with this query, you can see which types are dependent on other types from other subdomains as well. And in this case, those subdomains are well-bounded context in a domain-driven design way of thinking. And that means that you have those this meaning some kind in business terminology. Let's have a look at the time, most time-consuming analysis I did so far. It took 2 days to get this result. And it's about mining performance hotspots. So what I did here, we had some huge performance issues in our application. So we recorded some call trees that measured every method call from a stress test, for example, from a performance test. I took these call traces and read them into the Neo4j database via JQ Assistant. And the work there was, because they were really, really huge graphs, the work was that you have to identify which parts of your own application code are responsible for most of the database operations in this case. So what I did is I marked some nodes in this huge graph, like this year. So I had some request nodes that let you some calls to other methods here that are contained in my application. And this this application methods also led to some other calls or method calls that triggered SQL calls in a database. And with this visualization, I was able to trace back the problem to the root causes. That means that I was able to find some severe design problems there that triggered all those database calls here. So let's go to some more, well, daily work analysis that I do. For example, if you want to know about all your recursive method calls in the application, you can simply design a Cypher query like this. You say, well, I have a method and it invokes itself. And what you get are recursive method calls. So recursive method calls aren't bad per se. So you can add some application specific knowledge to it as well. So let's say you have this problem here that you say you have recursive method calls to the database, which is a bad thing because every read or write to the database is slow. So we enhance this Cypher query by saying, well, I have a method that invokes itself. And this method invokes some other method that's called DB method. And what is a DB method? Well, it's a method that's declared by a class named DB class. Then you can add what is a DB class for you. In the where clause, we say, well, a DB class has a name and it's called database. So this gives you every part in the applications that follow this pattern and give you some first hints where you can improve your code or eventually your performance. So in this example, I identify possible race conditions as well. In this constellation, you have some Java code here. It's a public class called owner-controller, and it has a field that's named owner's-index. And this field is private and static. So what does it mean? this static thing. It means that this owner index field is shared between all instances of that class. So when you have multiple instances of the owner class, it means that you get some really tricky race conditions here because all those instances override themselves. It's not a thing you want in your application. So I've created a Cypher query that's some kind of literal in this sense. You say, well, let's get all classes that declare some field. And you also have a method that writes to that field. Let's find then all the static fields via the where clause, where you say exists for that field the static keyword, but not the final keyword. That means that this field can be written by any instances. And you return the class name, the file name, the line number where this occurs, and the method name. How does it look like when in the Neo4j database? So you're always starting here in the Neo4j browser, where you can also have, or where you can also see some kind of inventory of your software system. These are all nodes that JQ Assistant scanned for you. So for example, here we have the entity relationships from the beginning. We also have some subdomains here that we also have seen in the presentation. And when you click on this pet subdomain, for example, you can see the underlying classes that belong to this subdomain. Coming from the race condition Cypher query, we can also execute it here directly. And what you'll see is that you have some problems here in the class owner controller and the method process find form that writes in line 110, the static field owners indexes. So this is just the explorative part of the analysis. What you can do is you can open up a new notebook. Race condition analysis here. And you can import your favorite frameworks like Pandas and the connector to Neo4j, Python Neo. So we say, well, let's connect to the default database that's running here on my machine. And you can take that Cypher query. Yeah. You can execute it and wrap it into such an Pandas data frame. And you can add your story. So get some context, like race conditions are bad, and so on. There you have also, again, this notebook kind of style where everybody can see what's your context, where you're coming from, what's your main idea here. You can add some more text that make it more reproducible what you are doing here. And you can summarize or conclude what are the next steps. OK, this is how it looks like. So I have plenty of those notebooks on my blog, as well as on GitHub, where you can see what are the mechanics behind all this and what you can do. So to summarize here, the tooling for data analysis and software development is already here. So you can do your first analysis with tools that you already know, like with Git or with Bash. And so those specific in-depth analysis are very powerful and worthwhile. Well, the next thing is that connections between the business and developers is possible. That means that problems can be attached to code that is business related. And you can also make the impact of risk-taking visible with your analysis. So I think this is a must-have to improve your legacy code or your systems in general. And the tooling with Jupyter, Pandas, TQSys, and Neo4j are my personal favorites because they provide many, many ways for you for identifying problems. And they kind of help you also to figure out solutions as well. So this is what I wanted to show you. This is the current state of my endeavor for software analytics in software development or using data analysis tools for mining software data. And I put some links here in the PowerPoint presentation that I can share after this talk. And now we'll be happy to answer your questions now.
Hey Markus, thanks so much for giving this presentation. It was really super interesting. And I think there are lots of capabilities and lots of options that you can go from there, right? So that's really wide field, and the more different data you can pull in, the more interesting it gets, right? So as you said, it's actually open to what's interesting for you in particular, and you don't want to answer like general questions. Something I would like to know in the domain-driven design part, how did you add the subdomains? Was this something that you would kind of determine together with the business owners what the subdomains are, or did you infer them somehow, or how would you usually go about that?
Yes, in this case, we derived those subdomains based on naming conventions. So in the example project that I had, this Spring Pet Clinic project, every class have some name in it, like clinic, owner, or person. And I used this information to create those subdomains here. And again, to find, with the next query, I wanted to find all those types that have those names in it. And then I assign those subdomains to these types here. So I do it cool. By naming convention here. You can do it with class names, with package names, but you can also insert some lists, for example, if you don't have such structures in your code.
Yeah, definitely makes sense. I mean, depending on your layering structure, that would be kind of also visible on like packages and things like that. And then probably also visible across modules and across languages and so on. Another thing that I at least wanted to mention is some time ago, I did a blog post which also allows you to visualize CVEs. So if you have something like a vulnerability where you have a transitive call that causes, like for instance, the one that from serialization or deserialization down to method don't invoke, you can also do security related things, and there are some really good projects around that as well. If you find like security issues, or like in your case, the performance issue, or heap memory leaks, and so on, there's a lot of things around this as well. Unfortunately, so we don't have any like public questions, but I have a question for you, which is, what would you wish for in this whole software analytics stack? What are the kind of things that you would like to see, or that are missing for you, or that would help you have an easier job?
My wish is that software developers dive into those data science area, that they learn that it's really easy to use those tools. So that would be my main wish here, because there's really a low entry barrier here. You just have to install those already pre-packaged data analysis bundles like Anaconda from Continuum. You can just download it, install it, and then you can start your data analysis.